our series on a larger life, and this morning the message is called Pull the Trigger. Pull the Trigger. And most of you wouldn't have been here this morning, I guess, but we called it Pull the Trigger because the Bible teaches us, we learned from Deuteronomy chapter 15, that the way you handle matters of generosity triggers God. And it's this sense where your life is like a loaded gun. God has loaded you with skills, and he's loaded you with health and family and friends and time and talents and money. And God has loaded your life, and he says to you, what I want you to do now from Deuteronomy 15 is I want you to pull the trigger. And when you pull the trigger, when you step into generosity, it actually moves God. I love this. I love this sentiment that something that I can do moves the heart of God. I love the fact that the one who is immovable is movable when he sees my generosity. Every time he sees me being generous, God begins to move. God begins to do things. God begins to do the impossible. Because our key verse for the passage is Proverbs 11, 24, that says this, the world of the generous gets larger and larger, but the world of the stingy gets smaller and smaller. The one who blesses others will be abundantly blessed. And the Bible says, and those who help others will be helped. Now look at this, the world of the generous. We spoke a few weeks ago about two worlds, how two worlds collide, and we'll come to that in a moment. There's a world that's generous within you right now. There's a world that's stingy within you right now. And both of those worlds are fighting, they're colliding. They're crashing into each other at all times. If you have a moment, grab the podcast from this morning. Because we learned this morning that in life, we learn in levels. It happens in primary stage, key stage one, key stage two, three, four. We do A levels, we go on to tertiary, further education, because we're learning in levels. You learnt reading, writing, and arithmetic in year one, but interestingly, you also learnt in year eight. And then as you get through into your A-levels and you get into university, there are areas of reading, writing, and arithmetic that we keep learning, because what we're doing is we're learning in levels. So there are levels of generosity. The Bible says this, it's not equal giving, it's equal sacrifice. So for one person, the idea of blessing somebody else by giving them, I don't know, £10 could be just the same level of sacrifice as what it is for somebody to give somebody else £1 million. You're saying, Glyn, that doesn't make sense because a million is way more than 10. Yeah, but it's not about equal giving. It's about equal sacrifice. God's not looking for how much you give. God is not looking for how, in what way you're generous with friends and with family and with community and neighbor. He's just saying to the church, listen, what I want you to have is not equal giving, but equal sacrifice. So whenever we take a vision offering, whatever, there's no pressure at all. Number one, let's take the pressure off. But number two, whenever we take the offering, it doesn't matter about what the person next to you gives. The whole idea is based in what do you feel God prompted for you to give? Because you're 50 or 500 or 5,000, you know what? Could be the same sort of sacrifice as somebody giving 50,000 or 100,000. But what I've discovered is this, we learn in levels. We learn in levels. And this morning we learned that generosity sets off a chain reaction. Like a domino. You push that one domino and the rest is a chain reaction and they fall. But I want to say this, that in the same way that the generosity sets off a chain reaction, so does stinginess. And tonight we're going to speak on how to break the stingy heart. Is that all right? Okay, there are two things that hold the church back in this nation, the spirit of religion and the spirit of poverty. And I believe that if we can break stinginess of heart, that it will fuel you, it will empower you, it will help you in loads of ways. Now, when I want to learn what a word means, what I do is I go to the dictionary. But I don't actually go straight first to the definition, I go to the synonyms. And by looking at the synonyms, I'm able to understand what the word that I'm trying to understand actually means. The world of the generous gets larger and larger. The world of the stingy gets smaller and smaller. So what does it mean to be stingy? What are some synonyms? Here they are. They're coming up on screen. Some synonyms. It means to be a cheapskate. Can you see that? Cool. Cheapskate. Cheese sparing. Cheese pairing. Stingy means to be chintzy. Frugal. Mean, mingy, or is it mingy? Miserly, money-grabbing, parsimonious. Come on, I'm teaching you guys over there. I'm teaching you stuff for school. Just put your hand up this week. Miss, you're quite parsimonious in the way you ask that question. Quite stingy. Penny pinching, Scrooge, skinflint, tight-fisted, tightwad. So what I thought I'd do is I'd take some verses in the Bible that talk about being stingy and place in there some of these synonyms that we've been having a look at. Look at this verse first we're going to put up here. A frugal planter, stingy planter, a frugal planter gets a stingy crop, a miserly crop, but a lavish planter gets a lavish crop. How's this next one? One day a traveler dropped in on a rich man. He was too parsimonious. He was too parsimonious to take an animal from his own herds or flocks to make a meal for his visitor. So he took the poor man's lamb and prepared a meal to set before his guest. Everyone say boo. Okay, next one. Don't eat with people who are tightwads. So here's the thing. If you don't like the word parsimonious, use the word tightwad. Don't eat with the man who is stingy, with people who are stingy. Don't desire their delicacies, the Bible says. Proverbs chapter 11, verse 24. The world of the generous gets larger and larger. The world of the smaller, of the stingy, of the frugal, of the parsimonious, it gets smaller and smaller. Let me ask you a question. Who wants to live a small life? Correct. Who wants to live a large life? Okay, you're going to have to be far more enthusiastic than that, because otherwise we're going to shut the doors and I'm going to preach this baby until you get it. God's plan is that he wants us to live a large life, not a fuller life. Brilliant last Sunday night, Hannah. Not a fuller life, but to live a larger life. And we answered that this morning. Why does God want us to live a large life? It's because Britain is broken. People are hurting. It's got nothing to do with what the government have done. It's because people are hurting. People are broken. People are loneliness. And the reality is that the Bible says that the church can be the difference. You are the answer. Sometimes we pray to God for the answer and God says, hello, McFly, you're the answer. Don't pray for change in the workplace. Be the change in the workplace. Don't pray for change in your marriage. Be the change in your marriage. Don't pray for change in your children. Be the change in your children. Churchill put it this way. He said, we get a life, we get a living, not by what we get, but by what we give. What's he doing? He's quoting the Bible. The world of the generous gets larger and larger. A few Sunday nights ago, I put up some signs of the poverty spirit, stingy thinking. And I want to summarize and just put six back up in here. Not all of them, but just six. Look at this. Signs of a poverty mindset. Sorry if you can't read this. It's really for me. Number one, sign of a poverty mindset, a stingy heart. Your instant response to opportunity is this: I haven't got enough money. If that's your instant response, before you actually go to God and say, okay, God, what are you saying? Before you actually go to God and say, God, is this actually a level you're taking me to? At this moment in time, God, I don't have the money, but I know, God, that you've got the ability to take me into a realm that I've never been before. God, you've got the ability to take me into a dimension that I've only ever dreamt about before. And I've discovered this. Every time God takes me to a new dimension, it usually requires a little bit more money. So you know you've got a stingy heart if your first response is money-based instead of, oh, God, what do you think? Because if God can dream it up, then he can come up with the money. Big difference. Okay, number two is this. An opportunity to bless becomes an opportunity to gain. We talked this morning, didn't we, about eBay. And I kind of said this, don't sell it, give it. We talked a lot about that. You've got to go on our Facebook, church Facebook page to see that. The third sign of a poverty spirit is this, is money and how to get it is your number one thought. You wake up thinking about it, you go to bed sleeping about it. You go to bed thinking about it. It's in your dreams. It's everything. Money, 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 money. Some of the richest people I've met on the world, in this world. I told you a few weeks ago about this story where I sat in a football box around the table with so many people. One was a billionaire, others were in their hundreds and hundreds of millions, sitting at this executive box in a football game, at a football game, and they're talking about their yachts, their houses, and all these sorts of things. And they were kind of, yeah, but my yacht is this, yeah, but mine is this, and I've got a chalet here, and I've got a villa over here. And it was fascinating to be a part of the conversation. And then there was a pause, and I said, yeah, but how are your families? It was a moment of tumbleweed as they realized, what good is it if you gain the whole world but lose your soul? Lose who you are. I don't want to burn my children and my wife on a sacrifice called money, on an altar called money. I'd rather be financially poor but family rich. Do you understand? 4, you struggle to remember the last time you were extravagantly generous. Extravagantly generous. Hannah, are you walking out because you disagree? Are you walking out because you got a baby? You got a baby. Okay, that's good. You struggle to remember the last time you were extravagantly generous. Extravagantly generous. This morning, we went on the Facebook page for church, the Audacious Church Swap and Recycle page, to see how generous is our church. And we did an analysis live here on stage. I had my computer and everything. It was amazing. It was such a great illustration. It actually worked. And I went off stage and said, thank God, it actually worked. But it was all about seeing, are people really generous? People were giving away beds, rooms, tables, chairs, toys, cars. Somebody posted, was it yesterday, on our Facebook page? Hey, if anybody needs a car, let me know. I have a Peugeot that you can have for free. I thought, that's amazing. When were you last extravagantly generous? Listen, the reason these weighing things are up here and the gym room, changing room is up here is because in a few weeks' time, we're going to talk about the generosity workout. How generosity is like a muscle. Pastor Mark preached about it a little bit just last Sunday morning. The reality is this, is when you use a muscle that you haven't used for a long time, you feel it. You begin to say things like this, man, I didn't even know I had a muscle right there. Who knew I had a muscle right here? You didn't know until you started to work it out. Generosity is that. And the question is this, is when were you last extravagantly generous? You know extravagantly generous when you go to bed at night going, what on earth was I thinking? We'll talk a little bit about that in a second. 5, you renege. Is that how you spell renege? On financial commitments and promises. And 6, you're more generous with other people's money than you are with your own money. It's easy to be generous in company expenses, but what about in your expenses? What we're going to do is we're going to draw our attention, I've got 20 minutes left, draw our attention to this amazing passage in Luke chapter 5 where Jesus has an encounter with a stingy person and his life is changed. Watch this. Verse 27. Jesus went out and saw a tax collector, Levi, sitting at his booth, his tax booth. Follow me, he said, and Levi got up, left everything and followed him. Then Levi held a great banquet for Jesus at his house, and a large crowd of tax collectors and others were eating with them. But the Pharisees and teachers of the law complained to his disciples, why do you eat and drink with tax collectors and sinners? Jesus answered, it is not the healthy who need a doctor, but it's the sick. I've not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. Levi was a tax collector. He was one of the most hated people of the day. Levi was a Jew. He was from Israel, but he was used by the Roman commanders, the Roman authority. They employed him to actually fill the Roman coffers. And so what the tax collectors did is they collected some for Rome, but they also collected them some for themselves. I don't know, did you get a letter this week from Her Majesty's Income Royal, what is it? Majesty's Revenue and Income, HMRC. I got a letter. Say, hey, end of the financial year. We're looking forward to receiving your money. Tax. And I'm like, yay. The tax collectors then were more hated then than they are despised today. Everything about them was filthy. Everything about them was immoral. In fact, even their money, that the synagogue would not receive the money of a tax collector because their money was tainted. It was considered to be filthy. It was considered to be an immoral thing. In fact, how's this? The tax collectors, though being Jewish, they were not allowed to even go into the synagogue, the center of the community and society, that even though they were Jewish and had the right to worship God in the synagogue, they weren't allowed to go into the synagogue. Why? Because they were tax collectors. They were hated. And the Bible, we just read it here, the Bible says that Jesus went up to Levi, who was sitting in his tax booth. It actually wasn't his tax booth. It was Rome's tax booth. But the reason it says his tax booth is because it's picking up on this whole stingy heart mentality that this is mine. No, it's not Levi. It's Rome's. And yet these words, he was sitting here at his tax booth, summarizes this whole mentality and this whole idea. And then what happened is this, is the Bible says he met Jesus. Do you remember when you met Jesus? When you met Jesus, two worlds collided. When you met Jesus, you didn't encounter a meeting. It wasn't a great praise and worship service. It wasn't a great preach. When you met Jesus, you encountered someone who changed your life, and worlds began to collide. There was a world previous where maybe life had been good, maybe it had been difficult. We don't know, whatever had happened in your world. But there was genuinely a sense of looking and searching and wondering and questioning. And maybe there was hopelessness, and maybe there was faithless. You were faithless, and maybe there were challenges, and all of a sudden, your world collided with the Jesus world. Hope, life, liberty, freedom, joy, grace, forgiveness, purpose, divine help, a sense of my life. God's got a plan and a purpose for my life. There was a collision of these two worlds. And even right now in Proverbs 11, the world of the generous gets larger and larger. The world of the stingy gets smaller and smaller. Right now, there's this collision. But the thing that changed you was Jesus. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Really? Here's the thing. When you welcome him here, there's going to be a collision. When you welcome him here, he says, hey, listen, I know you're worshiping and that looks good and you look fantastic. Clothes are great tonight. But you know, as you're worshiping me, you're going to find the Holy Spirit's going to say, you know what? You're carrying unforgiveness over here. I think what you need to do is you need to approach that person and just say, hey, listen, I'm sorry. There are issues that you need to let go. You see, all our life in worshiping Jesus, we have this sense of worlds colliding. And the Bible says here about Levi that worlds collided and a radical encounter with Jesus changed his life. He was rich. He had a great house. We know he had a great house because he had a massive party and he filled the house with lots of people. He had everything humanity could buy. He had the whole thing. But the thing that changed him was not the money. It's Jesus. I said to my friends around this table, I said, yeah, but how are your families? And they began to talk about brokenness. They began to talk about estrangement. They talk about how children who don't want to even talk to them anymore. And I thought to myself, you know what? I'd rather not have the yacht and not have the chalet and not have the car and not have that house that you live in and have my family. Actually, I'd quite like to have both. But I know what's most important. The encounter with Jesus changed him. There was a moment where you encountered Jesus, it changed you. But at that moment, you've got to make a choice. The choice is yours, which is why we're preaching on the world of the generous gets larger and larger. And I believe that our choice is modeled by Levi here in the Bible, because the Bible says in verse 27 to 28 of Luke 5, it says, Jesus went out, saw the tax collector, Levi sitting at his tax booth. Follow me, Jesus said, and Levi got up, left everything, and followed him. You see, if you want to break off the stingy heart, if you want a larger life, you got to do what Levi did. You got to. Do you see what I just did? You see, you can sit here with all the best intention in the world. You can have a gym membership for the greatest gym in the world. But in order for that gym to be any good, you gotta get up. In fact, it's interesting because in Psalms, all the Psalms, 150 Psalms in the old part of the Bible, the Old Testament, often when it talks about sitting down, it talks about when you sit down, it uses it in the context mostly of negativity and cynicism and pessimism. Psalm 1:1, blessed is a man and woman who does not sit in the seat of mockers. Blessed is the man and woman who does not sit in a seat called pessimism. Blessed is the man and woman who does not sit or take company with mockers. You see, you got to make a decision in your life. I'm not going to sit anymore. What I've got to do is I've got to get up. You see, I believe that tonight, in a few moments' time, we together can make the decision. I'm going to get up. I'm not going to sit here anymore. I'm not going to sit here in a sense of stinginess and miserly and be parsimonious. I'm not going to be all those sorts of things. I refuse to be a tightwad anymore. I want my life to get larger and larger. And the way that happens is you got to make a decision to get up. Now listen, I went to Bible school for 3 years. We read theology, Hebrew, Greek. We did all that sort of stuff. But one of the things they taught us in Bible school, Bible seminary, was this. They taught us how to critically assess and analyze things. They taught us to be critics. So I, like you, used to be able to be in church and listen to a preacher preach. And I would critically analyze and assess everything that was happening. The meeting order, the meeting flow, you'll know at the moment we're changing, making some changes with the meeting order and the run of things in services. We would change, we would learn how to critically assess and analyze the context of the preaching, the verses that were being used, the translations that were being used. And we were taught how to be analytical. We were taught how to be analytical. We were taught how to be critical and analytical. The trouble is this, there's a fine line between critical analysis and negativity. It's a fine line. And I knew when I was sitting in a seat of pessimism and cynicism, when one of the greatest church planters and builders in Australia at that time came and lectured in our Bible school, and he made a comment when he was preaching, and I was mad. I was mad. I thought, who does he think he is to make that comment over there? And you know what I did? I led a procession of students from my second year class. I led a procession to the president's door, the president of our Bible seminary, knocked on the door and demanded that that speaker make a formal apology for what he said. Because I knew everything. I'm second year Bible college, baby. I've got all the translations of the Bible on my shelf. I even read the Woost translation of the Bible. I'm cool. I'm sitting in a seat called Stingy, Parsimonious. My president was brilliant. He replied with these words, "Ah, you idiot." He said, let's look at the fruit of your life and let's look at the fruit of this man's life. But my stingy heart wouldn't give up. And then a year later, I graduated and moved to England. And we discovered really what it was like to be in ministry life. Because we had our youth group of a mighty number of 11 teenagers. And began to understand life a bit more. And began to get context to what he'd been preaching. And then 3 years later, guess who came to preach at our church? I went up to this great apostle in the faith who is still a great apostle in the faith. You would know him if I mentioned him probably. I said, "Pastor, I need to apologize." He said, "Why?" I said, "Because a few years ago, you came to our Bible college. You made this statement. I was so mad. I led a procession of people to demand that you write a formal apology. I'm just so sorry that I did that." And do you know what he said? "Oh, you idiot." And he gave me a hug. But you know why the apology was important? It's because I had to. Get up. And you know, for every single one of us in this place tonight, if you at all find yourself struggling with stinginess, the need to hoard, the need to hang on, impossible, so difficult to give away, then what you need to do is you need to stand up. Football games are brilliant for this because the cynics, they sit there with their shirt off with pie stains down their front. And they swear and they cuss and they do all these sorts of things at the player. And you just feel like saying, "What about you, you cynical slob? Get up." It's all through the Bible. There was a woman caught in adultery. Jesus said to her, "Get up." Yeah. and sin no more. To the paralyzed man, Jesus said to the paralyzed man, get up, take your bed and go home. Something happens. Something happens when you get up. When you decide, you know what? Yeah, Glyn, you're right. Though what you're saying is striking a chord here, and I wish you weren't speaking on it. It'd be nice if you spoke on other issues and helped somebody else. I just got to get up. Because God wants you to live a larger life. Get up. Corinthians 10:13, when you are tempted, he will provide a way out so that you can stand up. 1 Corinthians 15:58, therefore, my dear brothers, stand firm, let nothing move you. 1 Corinthians 16:33, be on your guard, stand firm in the faith. Stand firm in the faith. Galatians 5:1, it's for freedom that Christ has set you free. Stand firm then. Joshua 7:10, the Lord said to Joshua, stand up, dummy, what are you doing on your face? Stand up. And this is so powerful for Levi, because the Bible says that when he stood up, he left everything. I wonder, what do you have to leave behind? What are you carrying that's causing you to have a small life, a stingy life? The Bible says he got up, and then it says he left everything. Some of you tonight, I believe at this changed life moment that we're coming to in 6 minutes and 49 seconds, I believe that's what's going to happen down here right now. Some of you are going to come down here and you're just going to leave some stuff behind. He left everything. Some of you got to leave some of those. I don't know what the everything is for you. Maybe it's that memory of that relationship. Maybe it's a failed business initiative that you set up. Maybe it's a failed investment. There's all sorts of things that maybe you could say, hey, Glyn, that's my everything. But I believe that tonight you can leave that everything behind. He got up, the Bible says. He left everything. And then the Bible says, then. Everyone say then. Come on, say then. Say then in a stingy way. Say then. Say then in a generous way. Say then. That's what I'm talking about, baby. Then Levi held a great banquet for who? Sorry, who? He left his tax booth and threw a party for, come on, for Jesus. And a large crowd of tax collectors and others were eating with them. What happened? A self-obsessed, greedy, stingy man. He had an encounter and then he got up and he threw a party for Jesus. He got up then. He threw a party for Jesus. He got up then. I know you're then. 7,500 decisions in the last 8 years of Audacious Church. I've heard thousands of people tell me they're thens. Glyn, I didn't know Jesus. I counted him. I got up. Then. Everything that comes after is then. I read your emails. I see your tweets. I'm here in the comments, the praise reports that you put in, the prayer requests, it all comes back to my desk. It comes across my desk and I look through it. I'm hearing people's thens. I just can't shut up about Jesus. It's just like every chance I get, I can't help it. I'm shut up about Jesus. Before I hated him, now I can't stop talking about him. Some of you say, I just can't stop giving. I can't stop going. I can't stop loving. I can't stop helping. I can't stop blessing. I can't stop building. I can't stop serving. I can't stop getting promotions. I can't stop these I just can't stop. What happened? What happened is this, you got up. Then, I believe tonight what God's going to do is he's going to give you heavenly strategy on the then when it comes to breaking stingy and being generous. Now listen, in a few moments' time, 4 minutes and 14 seconds, this altar call, this change life moment is going to be dangerous, because for some of you, you're going to come down here and you're going to go away with a clear word from heaven. Then, I got up, went to Audacious Church, 5 o'clock service, which in 2 weeks' time will become the 5:30 service. I went to the change life moment. Then God gave me a word on how to be generous. Here's where the challenge starts. Because the Bible says here about him, then, then, Then he threw a party for Jesus. Then he invited all his buddies and said, hey, listen, come and meet the one that I've met. Then you got baptized and invited friends and neighbors and relatives to come and see you. Then all that started to happen. Then you started to celebrate. Then you couldn't shut up. And it read on and it says here, but, everyone say but. Now in the Bible, there are some good buts and there are some bad buts. This is a bad but. But the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, they complained. They complained. They complained when he took their money. And they complained when he threw a party for Jesus. Have you noticed this about complainers? Complainers complain. You see them coming towards you. You've already got them in the box. You know they're a complainer. So already you set up your filtering mechanism. You're like, here we go. They complain and they complain. Complain is complain. Hurt people hurt people. Generous people are generous with people. Stingy people are stingy with people. Do you understand what you are comes out? Everything, things that you do come out of the person that you are. The words that we speak come somewhere from the inside, don't they? You know, everything that happens on the outside comes from what's going on in the inside. And the Bible says, but they complained. And the reality is this, is in your world, there's two worlds colliding right now. There's a generous world in you saying, yeah, preach it, Pastor Glyn, preach it. This is awesome. And there's a stingy part of you as well going, But... Ann Adams told me an amazing story this morning. She told me I could share it with you tonight. That just this in this last week, God told her to give 20 pounds to somebody. So she thought, no problem. She is one of the most generous people that I know, hands down. She went to her drawer. She looked in her drawer, I guess her grocery, for the next few days. And she looked in and there was 25 pounds in the drawer. And she thought to herself, I don't have to give this money to that person anyway. If I give 20, I'm only left with 5. So she said, what I did is this, I just gave 10. She said to me this morning, she said, I felt really bad about it afterwards. And not because God piles condemnation, because that's not what God does. There's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, the Bible says. It's not shame on you, it's shame off you. That's the kingdom of heaven. But the reason she felt bad is because she knows better. And in that moment, one world triumphed over the other. The man goes to the psychologist and says, doctor, there's two dogs in me fighting. The black dog and the white dog. The good dog, the bad dog. The doctor says, which one's winning? And the guy replied, the one I feed the most. You see, if you feed stinginess, being parsimonious, you'll get smaller and smaller and smaller. But if you feed the generous world, you get larger and larger and larger. 19 seconds left. It's a fight, but look at this. Isaiah 32 verse 8 in the New King James Version. A generous man devises generous things. And by generosity, he will sit. Because Levi got up. Yes. Come on. Hey, complain is complain. You're going to complain that I take your money. I'm going to put on a party for Jesus. And I know you're going to complain because complain is complain. But you see, what happens is this, a generous man devises. You see, he encountered Jesus and he went, my goodness, Jesus is amazing. I got to throw a party. A generous person devises generous ways. Here's our change life moment. Would you all stand to your feet across this place? Listen, I know you. You're like me. Every time, like we looked at this morning, we go to a new level in generosity, a new level in forgiveness, a new courage in faith. It's sometimes hard, isn't it, to get over the edge. In the coffee shop this morning, I talked to the lady who gave away a Peugeot 30769, whatever it was. She gave it away and she said to Sophie, she said, it was so hard to do it. It's the hardest thing ever. But when I did it, she said, I just feel bigger. A generous person devises generous things. Oh, Lord, I pray, would you unlock in this house a spirit of generosity, where we're generous with our spouses and our children, our extended family, our community, and our workplace, because generous people devise generous things, and it is by generosity that we shall stand. So here's the thing. I don't know where you stand on the generosity scale, but here's the thing. It's a scale where you keep learning. We learned this morning, we learned just a moment ago, 10 pounds, you giving 10 pounds is equivalent to somebody else giving 100,000 pounds, because it's not about equal giving, it's about equal sacrifice. You serving and volunteering 1 hour in the local community may be similar to somebody else serving and giving 10 hours in the local community. It's not about equal, it's about equal sacrifice, not about equal giving. And I want to pray for you right now across this place in a change lives moment right now. We've got a few moments to do this. I want to pray that you would have the courage this week, wherever you find yourself, that you would find yourself going, I'm getting up. For some of you, you're at step number 9. You're about to go to step number 10, which is step number 1, but on a new level. You've been stuck on level 9 for a little while. You know what's going to happen right now? You're going to get up. God's going to help you devise ways that you can go to step number 10. For some of you, you're on step 49. You're thinking, man, step 50 is a tough one. Well, my prayer is that tonight you're going to have the courage and the ability to hear from heaven on how you can be generous in some way with someone near you, that you can go to step number 50. Because I believe that we just keep learning in levels. I want to pray for you tonight. You're fighting. You're thinking, I've got to work harder. I've got to sell everything. I've got to do all those sorts of things. And God said, no, what you've got to be is generous. Generous in words, generous in time, generous in serving, generous in forgiveness, generous in love, generous in their thinking, generous. So come on, Holy Spirit, you're welcome here. We're just going to open this altar for a moment. Would you come down the front? We're going to pray for you across this place. Whether you're a first-time Christian or you've been a Christian for many years, you're saying, Glyn, would you include me in this prayer? I want to go to a new level in my generosity. I want to break off any stinginess of heart. This is a next-level thing for me, and I want you to pray for me that I would become a next-level generous person. Come quickly as we sing. Holy Spirit, you're welcome in this place. Hey. It is hard because there's always a but. You kind of have this moment of God saying, really? Where you say to God, God, really? Again? You want me to do that again? The lady this morning who gave away a Peugeot, she said, now the challenge is, next time I've got to give away a better car, don't I? I went, it's up to you, but the world of the generous gets larger. I want a large life. You to have a large life. Come on, for those of you in the altar call, would you lift your hands to heaven right now? For those of you who are saying out there, hey, it's good for these people, would you, in standing out there, reach your hands towards these people in the altar? A generous person devises ways to be generous. Holy Spirit, I pray right now, would you cause every man, woman, boy, girl, the oldest to the youngest, at this altar right now in this moment. Lord, I pray, would you just give them strategy right now from heaven, something that they can and should do this week that would take their life to a new level and cause them to be larger people, I pray.